You have to live on your own and independent. If you are waiting for the forward vaccine, you don't know when, and you don't know how effective that will it come to your body. But if you use your body, that if you do your body to be healthy and strong, whatever the disease go to you, then you can fight it by yourself, not waiting
for the medicine.
If you have the best medicine but you don't have good digestive system, or you don't have a good food, or you don't have good body, then you cannot get the good thing from that best medicine. It won't work if you are not ready for them.
สวัสดีครับ
สวัสดีค่ะ
ยิตราวาดีHemantarop, or better known as Dao, and her wonderful husband, Wiwat Hemantarop. They are both the founders of Tonklar Fasai, and they are my guests on this episode of Inside Ideas, brought to you by 1.5 Media and Innovators Magazine. I want you to tell you a little bit about both of these lovely guests. Dao is a pharmacist and nutritionist and is the co-founder with her husband of Tonklar Fasai. It's a restaurant and also a place of healing and nutrition, where food is something very centered, because if you eat better and use food and eat food as a medicine, you can see tremendous results. He suffered for 10 years with severe depression, and made it her mission and her wish and desire in life to spend her life in a positive environment, healing herself and helping others to do this. And that is how this social enterprise, this restaurant and business of producing, making, eating food came about from Tonklar Fasai. The motto is let's start by eating right. You are what you eat, and to live well in the future is to eat well today. While vitamin and food supplements are derived from fruits and vegetables, wouldn't it be better to take food nutrients directly from the sources? Tonklar Fasai is not just a restaurant, it is what they proudly call a social enterprise. This business does not only yield financial returns to these wonderful founders, but also yields healthy lifestyles and longevity in a modern society. This business model is just not about the restaurant, but it has a wonderful food care center where Taylor makes nutrition and care for each of its customers to help them on the right path for their type of nutritional and eating habits. Their mission is to change people's habits and the way they eat food, to provide a service at the restaurant and at their clinic, to aim to educate and show people the incredible benefits of eating healthy. They have numerous examples of how they do this, but I want you to know that they're very accredited, and they've done a lot of research and put a lot of effort into making sure this is done properly. Dao has this pharmacist background, and her husband, Wiwat, is wonderful in his way, because he has strong business and marketing, economic background. He has two master's degrees in business and marketing management, and he really wanted to do a social business, and the two of them together have come up with a social enterprise that is really changing the world. They worked with Mahidol University, on research and accreditation, as well as with Siriya Hospital, one of the leading hospitals in Thailand and Bangkok, that has applied Thai traditional medicine with plant-based medicine and health and nutrition to come up with recipes, a philosophy of Paman Amai, I think, am I saying that right? Which is basically healthy and natural methods of food, taking it from the farm to the fork and producing wonderful, healthy body, healthy mind, and healthy behavior philosophy in the way they do food. I want to welcome you both to the show. Thank you so much again for being on the show and taking your time. How are you?
We are fine. Now we want to show all the audience our restaurant. Also, then we said here is a bit dark or something that then you all will see. We also have some food to show.
Great. I appreciate you both being on the show, and it's so good to see you both. And we know each other. Just for our listeners, we met when I was in Thailand. I was doing a tour of organic farms. I was doing a tour of healthy restaurants, vegan restaurants, plant-based restaurants. And it was referred to me not only from Food Innopolis, which is a big food and policy event in Thailand and Bangkok that I attended, and Wirat was also part of that, they says you absolutely have to go to Thongklar Phasai, and so I did, and you spoiled me. It was a wonderful event, and I saw all the fabulous things you're doing to help people with healthy food, nutrition, and to find a right way to show them that it's easy to do, that the benefits are fabulous, and that it's also just a better model for life. And I have always said that if you cheapen food, you cheapen life. And so I love your philosophies and the way you do things. And I'm so honored to have you here on the show. My first question for both of you is, when I was last in Thailand, it was before the pandemic. I was right there. Actually, as we already knew, it was starting to go. But everybody was already wearing face masks. And the reason why is because the air pollution was so bad at the time. It was probably one of the worst times ever in Bangkok, especially of air pollution. So people had already been wearing masks for at least a month, if not a couple months, because of the bad air pollution. And then you guys have a very beautiful way of greeting people, and a little bit of a social distancing just from a cultural way. You guys are very hospitable. And so you weren't wearing masks because of the pandemic. But I also noticed that during the pandemic, your numbers remained low in the beginning, that you had some preventative measures in place. I want to know, one, how you've weathered the pandemic as a business, as a family, as a life, has doing this business and doing your way of thinking about food helped you through the pandemic any better? Has it put you in a unique place to help others? And how have you been? How has it been this crazy time for you guys?
The pandemic is quite, for the restaurant, the dine-in is zero, because we have to close down, to lock down the restaurant. So the people, they're not traveling outside their home, right? They have to lock down themselves at their home. But on the other hand, I think everywhere in the world, they have the same behavior that the e-commerce and the food delivery, they are increasing. But for Thongklar Phasai, since our food is more immune, immune health booster as well. So our sales, I would say that surprisingly, that our sales has increased, yeah, during the pandemic. Yeah, but we don't think that it's gonna be sustained for a long term unless we have to put more marketing effort later on. But just for a short term, it is okay for us, you know, because we have developed some ingredients, something new, and we have worked with Sirila's applied Thai traditional medicine also. They also have some traditional juice. It's a traditional juice herb.
Immune booster.
For immune booster. Yeah. But by the way, I would say further from Bengka Far side that because of pandemic, it has impact the economy. So there are huge amount numbers of unemployment in Thailand. And the people are thinking that because Thailand, we are agricultural country. We are not industrial country. But because of the world development, economic development, we can call it like imbalance growth. Then it has created some much more industrial sector rather than just food or agricultural sector is in Thailand. But now we are coming back to be the right track. So there are more food and more agricultural sectors development here in Thailand. And from Tonka Phasai, we are also part of that development because we try to use as much as we can the organic or the gap, you know, the good agricultural manufacturing practice, you know, that to minimize the chemical uses for plantation, in which that the people can have the very good food for their good health. And this is some impact of the pandemic that have a relation with the Tonka Phasai. Yes. Just to answer your question, Kumar. Yes.
That's wonderful. Yeah. I want to go a little bit deeper. So around the world, all food services, all food producers are what they consider essential services. And I have a lot of friends and a lot of companies and people involved in the food production and agriculture and food delivery, food services. And some of them, especially in the gastronomy area, were hit extremely hard because restaurants and places of business were shut down. But many of them did a pivot and saw that many people were in lockdown, didn't have the same nutrition and food. A matter of fact, just in Bangkok, there was a chef and Thi Nui, a good friend of mine who you've seen the thing that delivered thousands of meals to hospital workers. And since you're already working with Syria Hospital and that, I was wondering if there's any way that you guys were able to help them for the not only the people in the hospital with maybe some healthier meals, but also the workers, because the workers were working extremely long hours. But also there's many other people probably in your community around the restaurant that maybe would have needed to see your health or your help and your health of your company and your products. I was wondering if you were able to be in a unique position to help them at all. And then the second follow-up question is, because you've had this this business for a while now, for 10 years, and you know about healthy food, you know how to do it in the right way, did that put you guys in a unique position to have some resilience as a business or resilience as an organization to be able to put you in a unique place to get through the pandemic a little bit better? I mean, I know you said the numbers shot up, which is pretty much all over the world. That's how essential services, especially food, they were off the shelf. People were buying them up, especially local things, like crazy. So I'd just like to hear your thoughts and your feelings about that and maybe tell us what you were able to do during that time.
Okay, we have three cases that we have involved. In Thailand, we are the Buddhists, and people, they offer food for the monk, you know, every morning, mainly. And because of the lockdown, you know, and the social distancing, so people have sacrificed that didn't have convenience sector or like we have to set the social distancing. So the monk has some problem to get the food from the Buddhist. So we help the service. Normally we do this because we think that monk is among the group of the people that got sick because they cannot choose the food. They have to eat whatever the Buddhists give them, you know, to the I don't know how to call it in English, but to the regulations or to the maybe the Bibles in Buddhist that a monk cannot choose the food.
Yeah. Because they're given what people give to them, and so they can't waste it, they have to eat it. So it's not really good. And I can imagine, and many times it's not very healthy.
Yeah. So our normal product that we have offered this type of service. We also give the good food for the monk as well as give the convenience to the donor, the Buddhist who has no time. We have the group of the people who are gonna offer the food for the monk. We are like an intermediate party to provide this service. And during the pandemic time, the number of demand has been increasing. Yeah, has increased quite a lot. So this is one of the role that we have played the role to be the intermediate guy between the Buddhist and monk. And we also, during that time, we also giving extra discount as well. Yeah, for that kind of food.
Then like a customer call us to give the food for monk on behalf of them. And then we have the team that prepare the food and then go to the temple and present it to monk. So they just stay home and they can do more.
That's beautiful. I really like that. And thank you for sharing that. I think that there's more opportunities than we know during a pandemic to really thrive and show people that all the success, the knowledge, the type of social businesses that we have, that they're not just for profit, but they're in a unique position to be able to help and give back. And all over the world, we've seen businesses that have had sustainable practices in place that have allowed them to become essential services and to keep their doors open during this time, or to pivot in a certain way to help others. So I really appreciate you guys doing that. And it's good to know, from what I see from you guys, you have definitely weathered the pandemic well. You're both looking very healthy and happy. And I've followed you and stalked you online for a while. And I know you guys are doing wonderful things to educate the people of Thailand and people who speak Thai around the world and different ways of doing things in a much healthier, better way. So as many of my listeners probably already know, Thailand is considered to be the kitchen of the world. It is one of my favorite places to be and types of cuisines to eat, because it is so multifaceted and diverse of the beautiful, wonderful things that we can eat. And it is really an agricultural food place of the world. That brings me to a unique thing and a unique next question, which ties really close. During this time of the pandemic, the only real big thing besides the pandemic that was a global citizen was food. Food was still traveling around the world, crossing borders, being delivered to people, and was the global citizen during this time of the pandemic. And we as human beings were in a lockdown and we weren't global citizens, and we're kind of in many ways not a global citizen. But my question to you both is, do you feel like global citizens, and how would you feel about a world without nations, borders, divisions, and the separation of humanity, where we interact with each other a little bit more like food, like air, like water, like the other species and animals on our planet that go around without any borders? Can you give me your thoughts or your feelings about that?
Okay, I can help Kundao answer this question. Actually, it is a fundamental of our setting up business. For Tonka Phasai, we are looking for the sustainability or something that can help the world. Because if for my personal, maybe for our personal value, to do the business. Before Tuan Kaa Phasai, I would say that the philosophy of doing the business, that we want to do something that can create a better world, because we both of us have really young children. You know, the audience is only 7 years old, going to be 8 years old, and the youngest one is 4 years old. So we want to create a world for them and their for their future. So as a global citizen as well. So we think that we are thinking about that, what kind of business that would be better and can help everyone. So we come up with many, many ideas. And then after we have met with Sirilat, Applied Thai Medicine, traditional medicine, and they have informed us that there are a lot of sickness people from NCD, and their age is very young, you know, and the dead person, the dying age ratio is younger and younger and younger. And most of them are the key personnel for the family. And once they got sick, they have changed, you know, from the key person to be the burden. You know, they change from the person who earning the money to feed their family to become the spender. You know, it seems like I would say that truly opposite from left to right.
Yes,
and
very sad.
So and the second thing that we are thinking about has we are talking much about the emission control, right? The weather, the climate change. So it's come up to be the vegan food, because the vegan food can help people get sick fairly late, and the cost of a treatment for the health treatment is also very, very low. And the most important is to reduce the social problem. You know, if the family members are the one who earn the money become the sickness, not just the money issue, you know, it's also the social issue that is gonna impact to the society. So if we make the people more healthy, they're gonna have the happy life, then we can have the better society. This is also what we are thinking about, that the food can help. We are not a doctor, you know, and Kundao, she's a pharmacist, and she's not enjoy to convince the people to use medicine. You know, although she can make the money from the selling the medicine, but will not be sustained. Then we are thinking about that, how we can make it more sustainable. And then we know from the world that vegan food is really the best for the climate to help reduce the emission. Because of the, let me go further in details that according to the study and to the discussion with Mahidol University and the Sirilat Hospital, we have known that there are a lot of wisdom in the world, a lot of knowledge in the world that plant-based can be much better than meat. So we think that this has become to become our model, and then our business model, we believe, and we have the strong belief and the passion that this one is going to be, can help the society and can help the world. Yeah.
Thank you very, very much. I truly see that your vision is a global vision, and you realize that emissions and the suffering in our world is a global suffering, that we're all on this spaceship Earth together. We're all crew members, and we all need to come together as global citizens to solve the problem. It's not just one country or the other's issue to deal with the problems, that we all need to come together and do it in what we call a global way. So a mix between global and local. The more local community gathering we have with this global vision is really important. Dow, I know you got these wonderful children. I'd really like to know from you if there's anything your husband left out, or if there's any other thoughts or feelings that you have about being a global citizen, and how you envision a future that's possibly also without divisions and borders and nations, that's truly global.
About how we create, how we
I'm putting Dao on the spot because her English is good. And
she's so shy on the camera, you know. Behind the scenes,
she's a fabulous representative. But for those of you who are watching live, you can see that they're coming from the inside of the restaurant, and they're sitting in one of the nice corner booths. Dao is usually the face, the Thai face of the company, and does a lot of great podcasts, but he speaks fabulous English. It's just probably not as good as she would like it to be. And so that's her husband just translated. So I know I put you on the spot, but do you have anything you would like to add to that?
So we share this from farm to fork concept. So we create happiness for every stakeholder in food consumption chain, starting from farmer, chef, restaurant, and also consumer. Beyond food, our restaurant show a movement for change, intention to provide food safety and promote healthy life. So now you can eat food as a medicine to provide, to prevent you from using medicine as the food in the future. So
it's more of prevention than reactionary.
Yeah, and to be food like a medicine, so we have to think a lot that our dish will be medicine now, but you can eat it like food, and it have to be it too delicious. Yeah. And you know how you feel about healthy food? Is it seem delicious?
Yes, healthy food is very delicious.
But in perception, healthy food is not feel that delicious.
For majority of the world, they think that's true, that they think healthy food doesn't taste good because they had a bad experience somehow where they've tried a plant-based food and they say, oh, that tastes yucky, that's no good. When vegan and plant-based foods were really starting to make a big movement, probably about 10 years ago, I tried some foods and they just tasted awful. Today, I've had the fortunate ability to travel around the world to taste fabulous foods. And I really think that we're shifting from that healthy food is actually great tasting. But there's an issue, and maybe you can address that. The issue is that if we're so desensitized, we're so used to eating bad food, our taste buds are different. Our body is also desensitized. It's also sick in some respects. And when you eat something that is raw or healthy or plant-based for the first time, and let's say you've been a smoker, or let's say you've been drinking a lot or just eating a lot of heavy fat, bad foods, when you first take this wonderful piece of food, you're like, oh, that tastes awful. But there's some secondary effects. I've had a lot of friends in the past, this is years ago, who were smokers and tried, let's say, some acai-based drinks or some guaranara or some makimaki or something good. And then all of a sudden they said, it tasted good, but right after that I had diarrhea the reason why is because their body's detoxifying. They're not used to that shock of that healthy food. So there's this a little bit of a transition period where our taste buds and we have to adjust to eating healthy. And sometimes it's weeks, sometimes it's months until we make that transition. But I believe for a lot of us that the initial taste of some of these foods are fabulous. Now, for our listeners, they can't see what you were holding up earlier, but what you were holding up earlier was my absolute favorite dish in Thailand, my favorite, I don't know if you can call it a dish, it's more like a snack, and it's Ming Kam. Am I saying that right? Ming Kam?
Yes.
And you're holding it up. And I want you, not only to show, but I want you to maybe describe a little bit about this Ming Kam and why I love it so much, because it is absolutely fabulous. Please tell us a little bit about that.
So first of all, I just want to educate more about why your friend got diarrhea, you know, because plant-based or vegan food has a lot of fiber. So when you got, you have more enough fiber than you have, you are, you can get easy to
stomach aches, you can get diarrhea because it's also cleansing you.
Yeah, it's like a detox your GI, your
it's a detox to your body and your intestinal
tract. Yeah, and everything that not good in your body, like when you eat meat, it's inside of you is boom, it's like a toxic. Yeah. So when you eat fiber, then fiber go.
Yeah, pushes it out. Yeah.
And then your circulation is balanced and it's good for the health.
Yeah, and I know a lot of people, I don't want to, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but I know a lot of people who have, sorry we're getting on potty talk or we're talking about the toilet, but it's a fact of our good gut digestion and the microbes in our gut. But I know a lot of people who eat unhealthy foods that they sometimes go to the bathroom every 3 days, sometimes every 5 days. That's not very healthy because you're building all those toxins in your body. And after, I think it's after 48 hours max, all the nutrients on that are out of the food and you're just building toxicity in your body and you need to kind of get it out. And so those people who've made that shift, they're like, I go to the bathroom a couple times a day, you know, and they're living much healthier. So I think it's just a better term, but yeah, please educate us.
Yeah, and moreover, our motto, our mission that we want to educate everything that is pre-goal. First, you have to feel delicious from your brain, not your tongue. And the second one, when you feel delicious from your brain and your brain will let you know that how it's good to your body, then you feel good that you eat good food for your body. And if it's plant-based or vegan, then you will be more feel
save the world.
That you is good for the world also, not only for you, but it's also for the society. And moreover, the last thing is you will have the healthy in return. So delicious at the brain. Use your brain to think it's delicious and feel
happy, have a happy heart. having a happy heart for the better world. So Kun Mark, you can bring her out, right? Now she's more funny too.
No, I mean it is right. First you have to consciously do it, put it in your brain. Then after you eat that and you realize that it's good for you, then you feel more joy. It starts to affect your life because not only once you get through that detox or once you've done it, eaten healthy food a little bit more, then you feel joy, you feel lighter, you feel like you've gotten all the toxics out of your body. And then the last one that you're saying it's not only good for the world, but what was the last one?
When you healthy, then you can do a lot more for the world.
Yeah. So not only are you not a burden on your family because they're taking care of you, but you're able to do more for the world because you have more energy, you feel better, you have a different view of the world. So I really like that. And I think that's so important. When I was there visiting, I saw, you know, a few people coming and going. You showed me some wonderful things in the restaurant and of the products and things you did. And I have a lot of fond memories of those times, but you were going to tell me about my favorite dish in front of you, Ming Kam. And one, if I was saying it correct, but if you could explain that and show it a little bit, it's a very traditional, explain the whole thing about it for our listeners.
We want to bring the past to prepare for good for your health now. So whatever is good for you, then we bring it to you in the food right now. So you know it, this is lotus. And this is a really useful flower. Not, it's not only just flower, but it goes for all the things of it. So we bring out it like to be miang kham, lotus wrap. So in one bite, you got 11 herbs in one, just only in one bite. And we...
It's like you can have all kinds of taste, you know. Normally we have a taste like a sweet, sour, salt. So miang kham, you get more
the
taste.
More of the taste of the combination of the thing that we put it together, the more taste, then you will feel the more delicious. And so, when you think it's delicious from your brain, it will be more.
So miang kham is a real traditional dish, and it's normally done with a green leaf. You have done it with a lotus flower leaf. And what you do is you take that flower leaf and you bend it in a certain way like a cup. And then you take the ingredients on the outside of that dish, and which are lime and pepper and all different types of, so 11 different types of things that you put into that lotus leaf, and then you eat it in one bite. So you're getting all of those out of it. And it's as my favorite, it's absolutely fabulous. But can you tell me again how you're saying 11 herbs and vitamins in there? Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
And then you can you imagine that you have 11 herbs in one bite? You feel, wow, it's many nutrients and antioxidants from many kind of plants, of herbs. And we also have the calculate the nutrition in one menu that is not less than when compared with meat, our menu is better than we have been
asked from the customer, from the consumer, that whether they have enough food or whether they have enough nutrition for their living or not from the plant-based. So Kunda, we have a calculation process.
Yeah, and we also have dietitian in the process that all of these combination will give you everything your body wants. Like if you want protein from plant, then we have keep quinoa and mix of
cashew nut and a lot of grain.
This is protein part, and this is when you have a lot of fiber, so you have gas. So we know that problems, then we prevent that problem by this is the thing that this combination will release the gas from your body, so you will feel good after you eat this. You not feel so much gas.
Help for the digestion.
Gas and bloating. Yeah.
Digesting. Yeah.
Beautiful. That's wonderful.
Oh, and you can, but and in moreover is for delicious is not only that I said that it's only not only in your mouth, but you can feel
smell
the flower.
It, yeah.
You can smell it. You can see that it's beautiful, so it, and it's also the environment. So everything when combined is more than delicious, it's beyond delicious. And when you know the story behind, and when you know the scientist base after this menu, so everything is perfect.
And this is the flower pollen.
You can eat it.
It's a flower pollen. Normally we won't check it, but this one, is it organic? Organic lotus.
Wow,
so
beautiful.
she's put her hard effort to find
the lotus that
really difficult to find organic lotus in Thailand.
So normally flower is just for show.
Yeah, for decoration.
Decoration.
Not for eat.
So it should be beautiful and persistent. Then they use a lot of chemical to grow it beautiful and stay longer. So we require a lot to have organic.
And so that brings up another question that I have for you guys. You guys spend a lot of time trying to find organic food, plant-based food that's organic. Do you guys grow a lot of that yourself, or have you made special deals with farmers that are already growing organic things? How does that process work? How did you do it? Because the organic movement is something that's just still growing in Thailand. So I could imagine that's a little bit difficult.
Yeah, this is our because we like a contact farming. When we seek, you know, before we open the restaurant, we do a lot of research for like 4 or 5 years before. Then we have the people that we know, we
go find the networking. Yeah.
And then we contact them to grow something for us. And something that we can grow on our own, because when you visit us last year, you see that all around our restaurant is a
yeah, it's like herbs garden. Let me show you. Let me share you about the business model that we have to create the demand first. We have to create the demand for the gap. Gap a vegetable or gap fruits the organic vegetable, organic fruits. And when we create the demand, then there will be the supply. And we believe that the farmers, they don't want to use chemical. But since that they don't know that if they don't use a chemical, can they have the high productivity or can they sell that product in the right amount of money that they can earn, they can feed themselves. So Ton Kao Fa Sai, we pay the loan like we call from farm to fork. We directly contract to the farmers as much as we can. Not 100%, but we focus more than 70% of our products come from the direct from the farm. And the reason that we don't do the farm ourselves because we do not expert in that area. Mm-hmm. So our role is to create the demand for that particular product, and then we also support them that they can sell in the proper price. So we cut down the middle guys, like we cut down the channel. So we buy from them the fair price basis. We buy from them a bit cheaper than the supermarket, but total cost is more higher because including transportation and logistics from their farm to us and the frequently ordering process. So we have the higher cost, but by the way, we also, believe that one day when we have enough quality, everything gonna be lean and we can get the better cost. And we are working harder to get a high demand. And on the other hand, we also talk to the farmer how they can improve their productivity. So we are the agent, we could say that we are the agency to bring them more demand and then increase their efficiency. I could download because she's a woman, you know, ladies, she loves the flowers, she know about how beautiful thing is. And like you see that as a man, I never smell the flower. I never smell, but I never feel good or feel much good, you know. But as a woman, she has more sensitive feelings for this kind of thing. So it can be like a good combination for this one. And let me add more point that we also try to have more seasonal product. Because if you have because we try to live with the nature, so we try to have a seasonal vegetable, seasonal fruits, then that gonna use less chemical, or maybe they don't have to use a chemical because it is the right season for them. And we do believe that the right season of the fruit or vegetable is also good for us at that season. Like for winter or for summer or for the rainy season, it seems like a natural natural cure. Yeah.
And it is our best luck also that we find the farmer or the this network, because we also have this ingredient at our home, so we can have like a nature product, good ingredient for us also. And our we don't have much profit in term of money, but we have like a lot of profit in term of healthy and happiness that we gain. And we feel like we can say that we are the first one or the first restaurant in the world that do a lot of research. And we have like a dietitian, we have two branches, and we have three dietitian, and we have one pharmacist, and we also have two marketing. We have a
supply sourcing team to talk to the farmer, to talk to get
sustainable
the
supply chain. And you also have cooperation with the university and also with the hospital. So you're taking a lot of time to make sure that you're researching and you're looking out for the best health of your consumers and your customers, and that you're not only doing it just for them, but you're doing it for the environment, you're doing it for the long-term benefits. Because if we can get the benefits of the health, if we can get the benefits of good health and longevity of a life, not only is that less insurance costs, but it's less hospital costs, it's less time spent away from your family, away from helping community to build and bettering the world, where if you're sick, or if you don't live a ripe old age because you're living an unhealthy lifestyle, those have a lot of effects, costly effects on our society, on our politics, on long-term sustainability. To be sustainable means to sustain yourself, your company, your family for multiple generations, to be able to have raw goods and products to produce and to have for a long term. So I love that thinking and that thought process. I have a real hard question for both of you, and I want you to answer it separately, and I don't want you to answer it for politics or for the company or for the world. I want you to answer it for yourself. And it's really the most difficult question. It's the burning question, WTF, and it's not the swear word. It's, what's the future?
What the future?
Okay. What's the future? And I want to know what's the future for you. And I imagine you're both thinking from your family together, but I want it from each of you separately. What's the future?
And I put you like, okay.
You can translate for Dao. That's fine.
No, she asked me to answer first. Okay.
Yeah.
Actually, this has come from my. Okay, I have been in business for many years, right? For more than 30 years, and I feel like I believe that I have the competency myself in terms of business model. So I'm thinking about some model that can be sustained, first one. And second one, that I try to do the business that can solve the pain of the society. That once I can solve the pain of the society, it can be the sustainable business, like a pharmaceutical, something like that. But I want to pay more operative role, that how to link to the natural as much as we can, because the more we are growing up, you know, the more we getting old and growing up, we are more closer thinking about the nature. So to live with the nature is one of my most favorite one. So this is come up with the idea. And the future, we believe that the food is future for sure. Also, you have the vitamin, also you have the more concentrate powder for protein, you have the protein powder, or you have vitamin powder. It's still not a food. It's still something like a modification. and you will not know that you have the right portion or not. Whenever you will not know, because you can eat it unlimited, because you will not get full with the vitamin. You know, you can eat it as much as you can, and it can collect into your body. But for food, you have enough. When you have enough, you say enough because it's full. So this is the limit. It's something like I'm thinking. So we come back to the food. In the future, that we want to have this restaurant, not only in Thailand. First one, we have to have this restaurant throughout the country. Now we have only two benches because we have to spend more time to get the right product for the right consumer, the right ingredients, and to make sure that the people understand the food and then to get it throughout the world and then, to all the country and then throughout the world. My dream, my passion, I want to have Ton Ka Pha Sai in Hamburg, in your city.
That's great. I want to have
it. Yeah, I want to have Ton Ka Pha Sai in Frankfurt, in Munich, in London, in Paris, in Rome, you know, in New York, in Los Angeles, in Chicago, because we believe that there's demand there. So the vegan is a future, because it is not just a food for your health, it is a food for the world, not just for your health. And unfortunately that the degree of the number of vegan customers in Thailand is not so high. Most of the vegan consumer are outside Thailand. But since that the knowledge, the wisdom, we believe that Thailand has the best, one of the best knowledge about the herb, the food. So we can say that we were born here. We were born here, and we will grow up in the world.
I like the fact that you say you want to solve some of the big problems of the future, and that you really want to connect back to nature and connect not only yourself to nature, but help others to connect back to nature. Not only as you guys are not that old, but as you're getting older, and that we naturally tend to want to connect back to nature. I believe that you will be able to reach that goal, that you can spread it around the world. I just want you to know that the biggest market that you could imagine is right there in Thailand. So if you can put the true cost or the true value to food and the price, the environmental cost, the human cost, the production cost, the resource cost into food, and produce healthy and sustainable food for people that is a medicine without being a pharmaceutical, that there's natural products that are organic and have the right minerals and phytonutrients and are raw and living that you can provide to people. Your market is enormous in Thailand for that transition. And the way to do it is exactly what you mentioned in the beginning, is to solve the problems that people are facing there. And it's I know you see veganism or organic as this kind of a trend. It's not, it's the normal. It's the way our future should be. And it's also the better business model. And so when we make good, healthy food the same cost as the junk food, as the unhealthy food, people will automatically go to the better choice, especially when they see that transition. And the way to really do that is to use renewable energies, non-finite resources, organic regenerative practices in the way you produce food. Use these modern ways of doing that, which also reduces the cost of goods sold, that drives your efficiencies up, and has your return on investment much better. So I know that is so possible. And if you do it in a place like Thailand, because Thailand is the kitchen of the world, I guarantee you, like wildfire, it will spread around the world as well. But now I need Dow to answer the question as well, because and it's not fair that you copy and say the same thing your husband did, because I know usually hopefully it's aligned, but sometimes it's different for every person.
Okay. Yeah. For the filter, I want like Ton Ka Pha Sai is the role model, is a is a idol for other to make business or restaurant like us. And also for me, as a depression patient, I don't know one day or when I go away from this world, but today I leave something that good and to give the world that you can do business like this. It's good for everyone. So like that is will that the future in my is goal, in my goal. And now I feel like I near it.
The target,
achieve my target because of you contact me again that you want to put our restaurant in your book so it will last longer when for the whole of
I appreciate it.
We can get more recognized in the world. More recognition.
Of course, you need to be recognized, and I'm sorry that I didn't contact you sooner. I've been extremely busy, but I've thought about you many times. I've reviewed the pictures. I've thought about the wonderful Ming Kam and experience that I had, and how you and I, Dao, we actually went out into your little what Germans call a Hof, your little area in front of the shop, and we actually picked some really unique little I guess they're called firecracker seeds, and we put them on our hand and a little bit of water on and they exploded. And just the beauty and the fabulous things that you can learn about food and plants and by knowing other cultures and people to see what a big wide world we live in, that there's so many options for us to do life differently, to do it more healthy, to do it for more benefit for people and planet, and one that is just a better model for the future. So I'm glad you guys are on board, and I'm glad to have you here on the show today, and thank you for answering that question, you know, the what's the future. So anytime, I really appreciate you guys. I want you to, you have a bunch more dishes. I would like you to bring them out and for my listeners, describe it, because they will only be able to hear and not see the beautiful dishes you have. But I would like to know why they're good, what the benefits are, what you have prepared there. And then I want to go in after we've gone through that, I want to maybe ask you some questions there. But afterwards, I want to give you some questions of sustainable takeaways that you can give my audience of maybe how they could replicate or do things similar to you guys to see success themselves. I think the biggest way of being successful in the world is by empowering your customers and your consumers to do exactly what you're doing for them themselves. And it's not that they're going to go somewhere else or find a business somewhere else, but by educating them and empowering them, which Dao does in her videos and recordings, not only do you gain a following, but you gain people who are aligned with what you do, and they take and spread it around the world. It's very rare that they would take it and steal it from you and be successful, but it actually is a way of spreading your business and spreading your knowledge that really comes back in a very Buddhist way. It comes back in a positive way to your life. So,
that's a key takeaway.
Wait, before you answer the key takeaways, I want you to show me all the food. I want you to show me all the food and explain it to me, and so that my listeners will know. You can even give us a little tour of your. Yeah, perfect. Okay, what one is that? That looks like.
What is one? Visit us.
Okay.
So, hello, guys, the audience. If you guys come to Thailand and visit our restaurant and you tell me that you come from Mark, you know Mark, or you know us from Mark, then you will get something special discount for you that is like the code. If you say Mark, then we have special discount for you.
Great, great. So they can come and try some of these fabulous dishes.
ก็ไม่ได้หรอกอยากจะแบบว่า I will show you เรียกแบบว่าทีมเชฟมาให้มา
For all the listeners, if you go to Thailand, you go close to Bangkok, and you go to Phang La Phasai, and you give them the secret code, Mark, that you saw the podcast, they will give you a discount on some of this delicious food. But they will also take good care and give you kind of the tour of Thailand. This that you're seeing on the bottom left of the screen in front of Dao and her husband is that you are cold pressed juices. They've been there a while waiting for the show and for us to do it, but they're like little shot bottles of cold pressed juice, and when I was there, I had them fabulous flavors. And that, tell us more about those.
Yeah.
The way the how to drink fruit or vegetable in big portion is easier to drink to have it like a drink, and this is cold pressed. Cold-pressed have 30% of fiber, just 30% of fiber, then you don't gain too much fiber from drinking fruit. You feel like it's more easy to eat like a drink than eat like something like this. It's more easy that you can drink. And in this only one color, four combination of fruit and herb inside of this, and every color represent for the
special benefit.
Benefit for each part.
Yeah, this the yellow one is the main ingredient is a ginger,
good and some digestion.
And some pineapple is good for digesting. This what's is the color one.
And what's the red one? Again,
the red one. What do you think? No, for the benefit.
For the digestive benefit, for blood, the heart.
Yeah, for your heart.
For the heart, is it has beet in it, or what makes it red?
Beetroot and tomato.
Wow, very nice.
And watermelon.
And watermelon, wow.
Yeah, great. And every fruit and herb that inside this, we have to do the research that it's good for your heart. It's good for this one, good for your heart. This one, good for your heart. Like that. It has lycopene. It has antioxidant that go to your heart. Something like that. So we just don't bring it together because it's red. So we bring it together because it's good for your heart.
Great. And that one's carrot?
Yeah. For which one? Which part you get?
For your eyes?
Yeah.
And skin, maybe? Eyes, skin, hair? I don't know.
Yeah.
But yellow and orange is represent for beta carotene. So beta carotene is good for your eyes, and it's vitamin A, and it's also for immune. So it for eye friendly, and this is green one.
Many vegetables. Yeah.
Has a lot of vitamin K in it. Probably it's. What else is it good for? Digestion, health.
This for brain, for your brain.
Brain power. Yeah.
We have some special vegetable that can help you release your pressure, have more relaxing for your brain.
Wow.
Yeah.
And this for your skin, because it a lot of vitamin C.
Great.
It's
great.
For collagen and.
It's another red one. That's what does that have in it? What's the red one for your skin have in it?
Yeah. So instead of you have the big glass, probably a yellow color or the green color. So we serve you in a small shot, and if you come together for two persons, so you guys can have every color in your one meal.
My goodness! So my all my listeners are going to have to make sure the minute the lockdown and travel restrictions have been lifted, go and visit and do that. But I also have a lot of fans and people in Thailand that still haven't gone and visited you guys. And so now it's the opportunity to take a drive over and come and visit you, say that Mark sent you, and you guys will get spoiled and get some good food. What are some of the other dishes? Can you describe some of the other dishes you have there? Is there a way you can explain them?
This is burger. Burger represent for junk food, you know?
Yeah, it's a burger, but what is the burger part made out of? Mushrooms, greens?
For hamburger, it's like we think about junk, but at here at Ton Kao Pha Sai, burger will not be junk food anymore because it's very healthy one. And
This one is a
plant-based. Plant-based is from mushroom, soy, and rice. Then it's like a...
Wow. Wow, very nice. A lot of salad and tomatoes on that. It's a plant-based burger. And then what is the fries or chips next to that?
Candy. Instead of eating french fry, but you have here this whole grain.
It's a rice chip. Yeah.
It's better than french fry.
Yeah, wow, that's nice. That's very nice. Thank you.
So this is the most healthy burger in the world.
Great.
And inside of it, we also have the many herbs, traditional herbs that good for your health and your digestive system.
Good. Thank you for sharing that.
I want something like tempeh sauce. You know tempeh? If you eat plant-based, so everyone will know tempeh is very popular among vegan person because it's this one.
It's like tofu or what?
No, it's a little bit more upgrading tofu to tempeh. Tofu is only the part of the water from the soil, but this you eat for the whole thing for the whole soil. You can
get soybean.
You get fiber.
That's beautiful. And then I noticed from the plate of that there's a lot of vegetables, but it has the stoplight color. So in the US, they say red, yellow, and green are the stoplight colors. And that's, you know, I'm seeing some kind of peppers, paprikas, yellow vegetables there, which is absolutely fabulous. When I was in your Shia in that dish, that was beautiful. Looks very healthy. Now that you're holding up is
the version tempeh.
It's fresh tempeh that you make yourself. I saw it last time when I was there. It's an upgrade from tofu. Yeah, it's a great upgrade from tofu. And if it's seasoned right, if it's warmed up right, it's just absolutely fabulous. So I'm glad to see that as well. Thank you.
So and it can be also like a pea vertical, right?
So we don't sell only food, but we also sell ingredients. Then you can make good food at your home. Like we don't want only like a one night stand relationship, but we want the long term. We want the sustainable relationship. So you can, if you miss us, you can eat at our restaurant. And when you go back to your home, you can buy something from our restaurant and you can do your own food. And it's also good for your health and you can do good food for your family or something. It's a kind of relation and you can consult us every time we have a like a WhatsApp. So then you can add us like an official WhatsApp, Facebook, you can inbox and consult us how to cook this or any if even you don't be our customer, you can consult us.
She loves to talk to everyone. She loves to share her knowledge. You know, you don't have to be our customer. Mm. At least you interest in your healthy manner or something that help your health. Then you can call her, you can contact her.
I've noticed that
quite a bit.
And the other one is about the soy sauce, you know.
Oh.
Normally the soy sauce, you have the problem with your high sodium. This is a special one that we have the friends develop together. It have a 70%
network. Decrease of you, not only the ingredient, but we also like a seasoning in our restaurant. We use low sodium soy sauce. So when what we use in our restaurant, you can have it at your home. So we have something like this to sell for you. So it's like we open, we share, it's made from our heart. And you can, when you come here, you can, then we call our restaurant. It's not just restaurant, but we are food care center. Like a fitness center, you can go for many things and you come. We have seasoning, we have ingredient, we have food, and we have like an expert that come to talk to you every
I love customer. That. I remember that distinctly. So not only do you have fabulous food, you have the seasonings, the ingredients, the sauces, the drinks, and that you also let people buy them, take them away. The fabulous thing that you're a food care center, a health center that people can WhatsApp you, text you, somehow message you, call you up and ask for advice on how to cook, on what to blend, if you have certain ingredients, if they need to get something. I know you guys will refer them to other places. So that's fabulous. And thank you for telling me this because soy sauce is something that's used a lot in Asia. And so it's also very nice to use that. What dish is that you're holding up right there?
Thai curry with sibai.
Chickpea and sibai.
Chickpea and sibai. This is called something.
Yeah. Chickpea and what was the other ingredient?
Sea
bright
is a traditional plant in our country. It's represent for omega 3.
Wow, beautiful.
No, normally omega 3 is good for your brain.
Yeah.
But we always found it in salmon.
In fish, in tuna.
But when you eat plant, how you can find omega 3? You can find it.
Yeah, it's really, you can find
it. And normally omega 3 will be, you have to use the oil, right, to distill.
So we
use the Thai way of the curry. This is a bit oil, a bit coconut oil. It's good that they can
dissolve the omega 3 is dissolved in oil. So we bring this knowledge to create this dish that you can get omega 3 eating
I can definitely see that you guys have put numerous amounts of thought and effort and love and care into your dishes and how you do your sustainable supply chain and how you process and cook. And I appreciate you taking the time to show me these dishes. Are there any other dishes that you want to touch upon or show me before we go to our questions about the sustainable takeaway?
Okay, it's okay. I think that we you used to have many, many press. Your audience can go to our
visit us. And we also have like a workshop or cooking class. We teach you how to cook like this.
Perfect.
Everything we made, and you can get our knowledge and you can do it at our home. We also have the workshop for grow the vegetable. Then you can have good vegetable at your own garden.
That's beautiful. So people will get your website in the show notes. I'll put in the description when we release the video, your website, where they can go that they know that they can get cooking classes and gardening classes, how they can grow that, all those tips I'll put in the show notes. What I'd like to do now is ask you our kind of last three important questions, and they're more for our guests and listeners as a sustainable takeaway for them to give them advice and help along the future. If there was one message that you could depart to our listeners that was a sustainable takeaway that would empower them to change their life or to change the way they eat, what would that message be?
Well, for me, you know, you have to love yourself, you know, in the right way. And then when you love yourself in the right way, then you will know how to taking care of yourself, and then you can love the world in the right way as well. This is the passion that we put our food that we are not fully vegetarian, you know. We are the flexitarian.
We are
the flexible vegetarian. We also spend our life in the normal way. We try to have as much as we can to have the vegan food, because we still cannot, even we have our own restaurant, but regarding to our the way of living and due to the convenience sometimes, you know. So my word that you have to love yourself in the proper way, and with a smarter way, and then you know that how you can love the world in the proper way, smarter way as well.
For me, it's like something you have to live on your own and independent. If you are waiting for the vaccine, you don't know when, and you don't know how effective that will it come to your body. But if you use your body, that if you do your body to be healthy and strong, whatever the disease go to you, then you can fight it by yourself, not waiting
for the medicine.
If you have the best medicine but you don't have good digestive system, or you don't have a good food, or you don't have good body, then you cannot get the good thing from that best medicine. It won't work if you are not ready for them.
To be the social entrepreneur, it is not easy. It is very, very difficult. So I want to share to the audience, if my experience or my work gonna be benefit to you guys, that you have to have first one, you have to have passion first, the passion and the strong belief that what you are doing is real good, and not good for you, and also good for the world, good for the others. This is a fundamental. And then you have to have the proper business model, like you have advised us regarding to that, how to have a better cost, the proper cost, comparing between the vegan and non-vegan, and then to encourage people to eat it. So you have to, in order to sustain or in order to compete in the business world, although you are the social entrepreneur, it's still in the business. You still have to compete, how to make it more competitive and to make it more sustainable. So you have to be able to find the right business model and the proper consumer, in which it's really difficult. Once again, you have to come back to your passion and your strong belief that it is the one that is good. So you have to do that. So then you will not be demotivated by any difficulties that you have been facing all the times, you know, because you are doing something that it is not easy. And the last one that I want to welcome or convince everyone that if you have a chance once in your life, make one good thing for the world, you know, whatever, whether it is small or the big one, make one good thing for the world. That is what we are trying to do, what we are doing.
That's beautiful. Thank you so much. I agree with that. And even though you are still in line as a social entrepreneur. You mentioned that you compete with other companies and businesses, restaurants. The way that I see both of you competing with them is with cooperation, collaboration, compassion. And it's a different form of positive competition, because if you are open, you're transparent, you give away your knowledge, you set it yourself, you have people sometimes call you and consult you that you advise on food and how to cook and do things, even if they don't buy from you, even if they're not your customers, that will always come back in a positive way. But that's also the hospitality of the Thai people. And there is a universal principle that will always come back to benefit you. And in that aspect, you said, do something good for the world. Right there, you've done it. You're already a success. You're fulfilling your passion and you're doing that. So I loved how you expressed that. I still have two questions for both of you. What should young innovators or people in your field of social entrepreneurship, plant-based foods, restaurants, makers of products, be thinking about if they are looking for ways to make a real impact in our world?
ให้พวกเองยังมาทุบเนื้อที่เป็นโซเชียลที่เป็นแพนเบสวิชั่นฟูด
be confident of your product. Plant based is good for every stakeholder, good for the world, good for environment, good for your health, and good for your customer health. So you are doing something good, so you're confident to sell it, confident to develop it more and more, and don't think about that no competitor, because the more plant, the more of plant based, and the more people eat something like this, you will get the healthier world, the better world. So it's good. Go for vegan, go for plant based, or go for like a add more plant in your life now.
So my point is that you have to have a, first one, you have to be honest and transparent. Why I talk about this one, because not all vegan food is healthy food, you know. Sometimes your vegan may be too oily, too salty, or not too
just,
fat, you know.
Just meatless.
Meatless.
It's not enough.
It is good for the world in terms of the environmental, but it might not be good for the people. So you have to transparent and honor to your consumer, make your recipe to be real healthy. Then the vegan food will not have any negative in the view of the consumer regarding to the nutrition. Because I have heard from some of my consumer that when sometimes they feel like it's too sweet, it's too salty, but when we explain them regarding to our recipe, it is not too sweet. But if you are diabetic, it's not good for you. But if you in terms of normal, it is okay for you. Because we have to have like a tasty as well, you know. For food, you need to have a tasty and healthy to come together, to optimize. If it is too healthy and you cannot eat it, we will not be able to expand or to gather more people to be more healthy. Because we are in terms of prevention, we are not the food for the sickness people or passion. We have the special one, but not in normal, in the common one. And then so my keywords are, you have to be honest and to be transparent to your customer. And the last one that I want you to believe that there are a lot of knowledge and wisdom in the world about plant-based food. That is a lot of good things. So you can go and research, or maybe you can go to the old research and the current research and even build up new research. And then we still have a lot of knowledge that we can be able to compete with the normal food one.
Yeah. I love that.
Every no need to have every meal, no need to eat every day, but you think that it's good for you and eat it some day, some meal, and you add more and more and more. It means like your behavior is changing and right, it will be better and better.
It's important to change those habits and those behaviors, and it becomes very easy and fulfilling and good. I agree with that. I also know a lot of vegan people or plant-based people that they're very strict about it. And some of them aren't very healthy because they don't have the diversity or the health aspects in what they're eating, and they're eating repetitive things over and over again. So I totally agree. And it's very important that you have that knowledge and that experience and wisdom to look at everything to make sure that it's healthy, that it's right, that it's good. The last question I have for both of you is the last sustainable takeaway for my guests. It is, what have you learned in your experience or in your journey, your professional journey, these last 10 years with Tonklar Fasai, that you would have loved to know from the beginning back in 2010? They say, boy, I wish we would have known this back then, that you could maybe depart to our listeners today.
If I can go back 10 years, what I will do that I will, you know, it's the first one that I will have to do more research in terms of consumer behavior, because this is something like inside out, not outside in. We make it because we have the passion to do good for the world, and we just have the belief that the people will love it. But when we, along the way that we are doing this business, we have found a lot of misunderstanding, a lot of unaccepted in terms of, they don't believe in terms of nutrition. They don't believe that this will be the good food for them in the high amount of the food. Like they don't believe that the plant-based protein will be compatible to meat protein. And it takes us more time to do that. So if I can go back, I will study more about the consumer behavior, then we will have more strategy to educate and give the consumer more understanding. And the second thing that we will open more restaurants, because when you have more and more restaurants, you can get more awareness.
You can also collaborate with each other more.
And you have the scale. So in the investment scale, in terms of investment, because we have a lot of high fee costs, you know, we have nutrition, we have the marketing, and we have put a lot of effort in terms of from farm to fork. So we don't have enough scale now. So if we have enough scale, then we can lower the price for the consumer, and then we can also expand the number of the consumer if we are cheaper and better. This is a thing that we think that from my side as an investor, there are two things that I will go back to do that. But I will not change the business model. I will not change that. I will not do this. You know, I will see that Tonklar Fasai is the right passion, the right model, the right vision for us.
Thank you. Yeah.
Honestly, I won't say that. Don't do this.
Very difficult.
It's hard. It's very hard. Because you were dealing with depression and that one, do you still suffer or deal with that, or has Tonklar Fasai helped you at all through this process to not be depressed, to be excited to go to work, to get up in the morning, to do what you do?
Yes.
Okay.
So if I can turn back time, I will tell myself that this, I will change my behavior earlier, because if the more early, the more I get
healthy
and better mind.
So you wish it's almost you wish you would have started sooner, not waited so long to make the transition. I agree. I haven't always been sustainable or been this. I made the transition about 20 years ago, but I'm the same way. I wish I would have started sooner. I wish I would have known sooner. There was a point in time in my life where I weighed 350 American pounds. I was very overweight. I ate unhealthy. I lived unhealthy. I lived unsustainable. And if somebody back then were to talk to me or tell me, hey, Mark, you're going to be this sustainable advocate in the future. You're going to be a health nut in the future. I says, you're crazy. It's just not going to happen. And the reason why is because I was desensitized. I couldn't feel my own body. I was suffering from all sorts of ailments and pains, but I wasn't in a place in my life to feel it or there. And it's been a transition over time to get to this place. But the biggest thing that I say is, man, I wish I would have started sooner. I wish I would have had a little bit more influence. It's extremely hard, but once you make that transition, the light's gone on. You can never go back and you're like, boy, let's go moving forward. And it's a much better way. I really appreciate both of you and being on the show. We're done. Unless you have questions for me or anything else you'd like to add, I think we're done and I'd like to tell you goodbye, but I want to give you one last opportunity. If there's something you missed or didn't mention, please say it now before we say goodbye.
Please remember us and Ton Kao Fa Sai as the business model that you want to do something like us. So we will be very happy that what we have done for so long and so far, we are more than welcome to assist you or consult us at any time. If you want to do something like that, we are more happy to share.
Great, thank you.
Yep, this we want to be the small seed, mm-hmm. a small part in the world. Mm-hmm. In the world, you know, you mean Ton Ka is mean like a small plant, and gonna grow up in the future. This is the name, the meaning of Ton Ka in Thai.
Perfect.
So we want to be that part, and one day when we grow up to be the big tree, we can. This is something like not a question to Mark, just something like I want to encourage all your audience that we help each other to be small tree, and then we all gonna become a forest together, and then the world gonna be really beautiful for us to live.
Thank you so very much. You've already planted the seed in my life and I'll never forget you guys. And now my listeners and everybody will know to come by, give the secret word, Mark, that you saw the show here, and make sure to like Inside Ideas, subscribe. And I thank you very much. And I hope we see each other very soon. Ka.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it. Thank you so much and have a wonderful day.
Thank you, Kunma. Bye-bye.